And let's go ahead and I'm going to open us up in prayer real quick. Thank you, thank you, thank you for being flexible. I know I keep looking for people over here that normally sit over here to tell you something, but thank you for being flexible. It's so it's a great honor to have God's House of Hope with us today from the Nelton campus. Where y'all at, Nelton? Nelton, there we go. And Kilmichael campus, yeah, right? All right, so and it's been an awesome week. In my devotion time, God has really shot my legs, because every day we get up, we continue. As soon as the alarm clock goes off, we think about everything that we have to do that day, and we just forget sometimes of the allness of God and what that should do to make us worship, man, just for help to wake up and help to walk and help to raise a hand in praise. We oftentimes, and this week I shared with you, at God's House of Hope, not God's House of Hope, Rosemary's Home of Hope, our fundraiser Thursday night, I told my wife, I'm like, it amazes me to sit back and watch what God can do just with a little of people. We had 17 tables there. Everybody had one vision. Everybody had one goal. It was to come together and expand the ministry and see what God was doing. There was no bickering and whining and moaning and groaning and selfishness and all those other attributes. You know what it was? It was the church. If our church would just come together for the common good to reach one more soul and say, hey, I'll serve unselfishly, I'll be flexible, I won't complain, because I want the next man to get a taste of what Jesus Christ has done in my life, we could truly be the church, right? So, anyway, I never in a million years would have thought I should, because God dropped some walls at Jericho. He can drop whatever, but it blows my mind to see what God can do. I've shared with you many times in the last 10 years, everything at the orphanage, everything that has done, I can't do. It's God and God alone. I can't do. And if there's no way, well, there is a way. I guess we could rob a bank, get Eliza as our runner so nobody could catch her, and I couldn't imagine how this right here raises money. But God has blown my mind over and over. I think we're like $200 away from $60,000 for our home. And so, yeah, right? I know some of you are team captains, and I appreciate that. Just, man, it's just been floating and floating. So today we've come, and again, part of our ministry, our church is going to feed God's House. I hope. I think we've got enough barbecue to feed them. We'll do that after services. I'll need just a few people. I think my class is going to stay and help serve, just a few people to help serve. Other than that, we'll get them run through the line, and we're going to minister to them. Other than that, we start a new church here. We have a business meeting Wednesday night. We have service Wednesday night, all right, but we will have to vote on our new church here. That'll be coming up. Meal 5:30. Be praying. We got a lot of stuff to do. But right now, the most important thing to do, the reason we're together is because we're two or more gathered. That's where he'll be. So I just want to praise him. I'm going to lead us in prayer. Lacey's going to open us up, and then we're going to go all the way through. And we're just going, I can't tell you what's going to happen. I'd love to preach Joshua chapter 6, verse 21. God may or may not allow that. We're just going to see. You know what we really need to do? Just get out of the way and say, God, you be God, and let us be your people, right? So let's go to God in prayer. If you feel comfortable praying out loud, you pray out loud. If you feel comfortable, raise your hand, raise your hand. You pray ever however you connect to the God who saved your soul. Would you pray with me? Father, I come to you right now, God, and I pray, Father, God, that you'd begin to move through the sanctuary, Father. There'll be speakers today, God. There'll be praises from our lips that'll go up. So I pray, Father, you pour yourself out on those that are leading. Now pour yourself out on those that are singing. Pour yourself out, Father, through those that'll be giving a testimony, Father. God, would you just move here today? Father, I know that you will move if we will get out of the way, Father. And everything that is hindering us spiritually from reaching you, from hearing your voice, God, everything that's hindering us from truly experiencing worship and pouring ourselves out before you, God, I pray right now we'd lay it at your feet and say, I'm sorry for holding on to this. God, forgive me for holding on to this. God, I just want to come, Father. If this is our last time together, if this is the last opportunity we have to worship you, if this is the last opportunity we have to preach, to sing, to testify, then God, let us give it our all as if we reach the finish line, Father, so that you can look upon us, Father, and say, well done, thy good and faithful servant. Father, Father, help us right now, I do pray. God, we just get out of the way, and God, we lift you on high, that your name may be glorified and that your name may be shouted from the rooftops, God, as we gather and praise you. Forgive us when we failed you. Now, God, again, we would simply want you to be glorified here today. In Jesus' name we pray, and all of us sin. Amen. Amen.
Yeah. And all the overwhelming, never-ending You have been so, so good to me.
Yes, you have. Yes, you have.
When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me.
Yes, you did, Jesus.
And you have been so, so kind to me. And all the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God, oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. And I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God.
Hallelujah. Come on, no shadow.
Woo.
No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
No
wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
There's no wall, no
wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Holy, overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Holy, overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God.
Father, I just thank you, God, just for an opportunity. Thank you, God, for moving. Lord, thank you for just letting us hear our piano play. God, now continue to move. Lord, I lift up our church. Lift up those that gathered. God, speak to them. My prayer, Father, today, each and every one that leaves can say, I truly heard the voice of God speak to me. Jesus' name I pray, and all of us sin. Amen. 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 Would you turn around and greet your neighbor? Hey, we won't pass offering plates there at the back of the front. We'll take just a second to greet your neighbor.
Thank you.
you're going to do a video, right? And let's thank you so much again for your fellowship. By the way, if you have a small child, I don't care if them crawling around or whatever, we're not having a nursery day because it's pretty lively, and that's a good thing, right? I like to hear crying babies. It's fine. Like I said, just bear with us. It's sort of a special day. Just a couple things. I pray that you can worship, because I promise if you can't worship here, you can't worship anywhere else. Because, if you can't express yourself collectively together, it's I dare say that we express ourselves when we're with our family or our friends. Man, this is where it starts. So a few months ago, actually about July, I shared a video of you. We're going to try to play that video again. Because I need to play it for you to understand the next part of our service. But I shared with you about one of the residents of God's House Hope. We've been lifting up in prayer. And obviously, I always tell you when you pray for healing, healing comes in three ways. It comes in medicine. It comes in miracles. And the ultimate healing comes when Jesus takes his children home. So if you're going to pray for a believer, understand those are your three answers for medicine, miracles, and then for God to take his child home, because that's not a bad thing, okay? And so you can see a video I played of Josh, who was having some issues and then was diagnosed that basically his heart was bad and that he didn't have much long to live. There's a picture of Josh. We'll try to see if we can get that to play. Our IT is trying hard. We're going to see if we can play that. But to give a testimony after this video, set this up, is Josh's wife, and I'll let her share her story. She's with God's House of Hope in Nelton, and so I'll let Caitlin come. Let's see if we can play this.
Thank you. was just hurting him and he was sick. So he goes to the ER in Yopora. They told him he had pneumonia. Well, he comes back home and he still could not breathe. And we didn't know it then, but he was suffocating because he had so much fluid on his lungs. And so I took him back that Friday to Yopora. And, you know, then they said that they didn't catch it was heart failure. And he happened to be in Nettleton doing some work, and he was trying really hard. And he told Amy, he's like, I can't do this. I feel like I'm dying. I can't breathe. So then we tried Amory, and so he goes there. They catch it. It's heart failure. Only 20% of his heart was working. And at this time, we didn't know that he even had a heart problem, like, at all. Like, he didn't have any symptoms or side effects. Like, we didn't know. So they catch that. They tell him he's a diabetic. Only 20% of his heart's working. He had pneumonia. He also had fluid all over his heart and his lungs because his heart was not strong enough to pump it off. So we stay in this hospital for 2 weeks. We start in Amory, but we get transferred to Tupelo where there's a specialist. And we go there in hopes of finding what's wrong. He goes through days of just suffering. He can't breathe. He's struggling. He's begging for help. There's nothing they can do. He can't lay flat to get his heart cath
I really thought you were going to preach my sermon. You told me you didn't look at my notes, and then you sat up here. Huh? I know, right? If you have your Bibles, real quick, if you'll turn to Joshua chapter 6, verse 21, I want to show you some insight here. I know where Prentice asked me, he said, hey, when are we going to get to chapter 7? That's my favorite chapter. I don't know. It took us about a year and a half to go through the book of Acts, and so we're in chapter 6 of Joshua, but I just want to share something really quick with you, and then I just feel like when we started in Joshua chapter 6, God's word reminds us over and over and over of these walls, these absolutely walls that can't be broke through. I feel like most of us, and even at times in my life where I fail because I feel like the wall won't be broken. What wall is it? Every one of us in here have spiritual walls up in your life that you truly, truly, truly want to be broken down. It's walls that's keeping you from joy. It's walls that are keeping you from worship. It's walls that are keeping you from all your blessings that God is trying to get you, but instead you're focusing on the walls and not focusing on your Savior. You're focusing on the walls and not focusing on worship. And just here is, Caitlin just magnified what God had already showed me. In Joshua chapter 6, I'm going to read one verse, and I'm going to preach chapter 6, verse 21. If you'd stand with me in honor reading God's word, there's one word here that is going to stand out and I'm going to end with, but I want to go back. And they utterly destroyed all that was in the city, both man and woman, young and old, and ox and sheep and a donkey with the edge of the sword. I want to go back. And they utterly destroyed. I need everybody to say that word. And they utterly destroyed. Just word, not the S. I need you to say that word, not words. I'm just kidding. All right, everybody's staring at me. All right, here. I'm going to read the first. I'll point to you when it's your turn, all right? And they utterly destroyed. And they utterly destroying. And they utterly destroying. I'll come back to that in just a second. I want that on your mind, though. One more time. And they utterly destroying. Father, thank you for the reading of your words. Now I pray, Father, you just lift us up, God. I pray right now, Father. Father, we'd lift you up, Father. But most of all, God, we'd be hid from this place, Father, that your words would be magnified. God, use me as your mouthpiece, as your messenger this morning. I pray, Father, you just pour your words out that I need to hear. I pray, God, that you'd pour words out that would encourage me, that would, God, just, God, give me the strength to continue on. And I pray as I preach to myself that others may hear the same message that you're trying to relay to me. Most of all, God, I pray if there's someone here that's got walls up, they've never given their life to you. God, whether it's pride, whether it's bitterness, whether it's anger, whether it's a don't care attitude, whether it don't bother anybody else, whatever the philosophy, God, that they're hanging their life on, that wall, I pray, will come down today. God, hear us now as we pray and we look to your words in Jesus' name, and all of us said, amen, amen. Thank you, you may be seated. How do our walls come down? Walls must come down. The Bible says there that all were destroyed in the city. As the children of Israel are marching around, as the children of Israel now crossed the Jordan, and now there's walls that's standing. If you go back over and you see when the first spies went in, there in the book of Numbers, you'll see that they saw that the wall was too big, that the people were too big, that everything was too big for God, if you will. And so now we get to Joshua chapter 6, and we're going to see in verse 20 that the walls actually come down. So my question is, if we look at this from a spiritual aspect, is how do we get those walls to fall in our life? And the first thing God says to me, number one, this is the way walls fall. Walls fall spiritually for those that stay close to the sanctuary. If you look right there in verse 13, listen what the Word of God says. And the seven priests bearing up seven trumpets, ram's horn before the ark of the Lord went continually and blew the trumpets. And here it is. And the armed man went before them. Other words, what you and I, when depression sets in, when discouragement sets in, when disaster sets in, it's for us to make sure we're at the sanctuary of God. And we come to worship God. And we begin to sing praises to God. The problem is, I'm afraid, when life starts crumbling in and when things start crumbling apart, instead of running to the church, we run away from the church. And don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that this church house is a place where that we find God in the four walls. What I'm saying is, collectively, when we come together and make up the church, the people wanted to be next to the ark because that's where God was and representing the church of Jesus Christ. If your walls are going to come down, you've got to stay in the church. No wonder the writer of Hebrews said what? Forsake not the assembly. If your spiritual walls are going to fall so that you can have freedom, so that you can have joy in your life, it starts with staying close to the sanctuary of God, right? It's where God's word. It's pretty simple. It's even in my life. My wife is one that sort of like my teacher in the playground. She tells me, hey, you need to do this. Hey, don't go too far. Hey, do this. But then she says, hey, why don't you go and hear him preach? Why don't you go here? It's for you to get spiritually fed. It's to be in close to the source that's coming from the spout. I heard out there at the youth revival in Revelation, the lukewarm water, the reason the water was so lukewarm because it traveled all the way from that one city to the next. So that tells me if you want refreshing water, not lukewarm water, you got to be close to the spout where it comes out, right? That's why we gather at the church. If your walls are going to fall in your life, it means you've got to stay close to the sanctuary. It's the first thing. But the second thing, boy, I like this. Woo-hoo. Those that will see walls, spiritual walls, fall in their life and conquer spiritual battles, not only be those that stay close to the sanctuary, but those that will shout the praises of God. Look at verse 20. Listen to what God's word said in verse 20. It says, so the people shouted when the priest blew the trumpets. And it came to pass when the people heard the sound of the trumpets, the people shouted with a great shout. And the wall fell down flat, so the people went out the city. Every man straight before him, and they took the city. What I want you to understand is when you convert this word shout, it means to rejoice. Then we say, man, they shouted and the walls fell down, the trumpets blew the horn. What you don't understand is when you put yourself in these people's place, can you imagine the anxiety of marching around a city where you know everybody in there is twice as tall as you? Everybody in there is muscled up like me, and you feel like that you may feel like you're like, I'm just kidding. If you read the report, they said, man, we look like grasshoppers, according to those people. So can you imagine them marching around a wall thinking, what's going to happen when those giants come out of the city? The anxiety, the unknown, the fear. Think about it. Paralyzing. Just keep marching. Hey, we're staying close to the sanctuary, but keep marching. Keep marching. Keep marching. But you don't know what I'm going through. I can't let go. I'm too afraid. I'm too scared. I don't have courage. I'm stuck in a rut. I'd rather stay in a rut because it's comfortable. I'd rather stay right here and sit on a pew and not just absolutely run and fall on my face. It's because it's comfortable here. No one bothers me here. I feel, but yet all this anxiety, I know it's not liberating. I'm just absolutely a mess. I can't have peace. I can't have freedom. I can't lay my head down at night. And what God is saying is, it's what you and I need to do. What Caitlin has said is, even in the storms when you're marching around the unknown, it's to sing praises to God and shout, rejoice, 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 even though you didn't bear the child. Rejoice. This is what she said from Isaiah chapter 54, verse 6. Rejoice. It's rejoicing in the unknown, rejoicing in the fear. I share with you my mother-in-law on Wednesday night. So it was stage 4 brain cancer. Not mother-in-law. I got it right. Stepmother. Thank you. I knew. See, I told you she was like my teacher. So I get those mixed up. Halves, steps, and what's the other one? In-laws. I got it now. In-laws and outlaws. I got it. But you get my stepmother. Stepmother has stage 4 brain cancer. It's cancer in her lungs, cancer in her spine. We went to visit her the other day. I shared with you this on Wednesday night. She said, I've never been so happy in my life. How? You're walking around a city that you don't know the enemy that's on the inside. It's called cancer. It's called heart disease. How can someone say that? The other end of the story is she's been to the sanctuary. Oh, you know she's been to Brother Kevin Bayless's church. Yeah. And she's learned that when things are falling apart, praise him. When you can't control those things, praise him. The group that sang here a few years ago said, God loves the hallelujahs from the valley. Can you sing in the valley like you do on the mountaintop? It's those that shout praises during the unknown, when they don't know what's going on, when everything seems to be falling apart. If those walls are going to fall, then it's going to require you and I to stay close to the sanctuary, but it's going to require us to shout praises to God no matter where you're at in life. Right? Last but not least, you've heard this. Walls fall when we stay in the sanctuary, and walls fall when you and I shout the praises. But the Bible says in verse 21, walls fall when those swing the sword. That tells me if they killed everybody with the edge of the sword, that tells me the whole time they're marching, the whole time they're going into the unknown, the whole time when they didn't know where they were going, the whole time when they couldn't see the light at the end of the tunnel, for them to kill everybody with a sword means they had to carry the sword. Let's echo it. I just stayed in my word. I think she said that. I just stayed in my word. I stayed in my word. When I was talking to Walt, he said, hey, let me show you what I found in Ezekiel. I stayed in my word. I stayed in my word. The reason she found Isaiah chapter 56 is because she was in her word. You don't just pop up things. Those that carry the sword, their walls will fall. Sadly, I'm afraid this sword is not being carried among God's people. It's staying in the Bible, this sword. God, our country's falling apart. What's going on? Fret not for tomorrow, for you may not even be here. Who knows your life except me? It's only a vapor. God, how am I going to handle this? 1 Corinthians. I will not allow you to be tempted. Let me be very clear. Let me go ahead and knock out some Facebook philosophy, all right, and theology real quick right here, all right? God will never put more on you than you can bear. It's 1 Corinthians. That's not applied correctly in that statement. What he's saying is he will not allow you to be tempted and more than you can handle. You make a bunch of bad choices, and you have a bunch of consequences come on your life, and then you want to tell me, well, God won't put more on me. He didn't put anything on it. It's your choices. That's who put stuff on your life. But God is faithful to say, hey, allow my son to be tempted, but I won't allow you to be tempted above more than I know you can handle. So that means every time that you're tempted of the devil, he's had to get permission. You're God's child. And if he got permission, that tells me there's a father that's standing and said, hey, I tell you what, I got a servant over there. Her name is Lacey. You just go ahead, because I got faith in her. I've seen her worship. I've seen her stay at work. I've seen her live praises. Hey, I got a servant. He's sitting back there. I got a servant that's sitting over there. I got a servant that's sitting over there. You go ahead and tempt them, because I will not allow you to tempt them more than they can handle, because they are in the sanctuary. They are in the word. They keep the sword of God, and they sing praises to me, and walls fall down. That's what Jesus said. Oh my goodness, church. If we get just this there. So there's my introduction, so I'll close with my message. Chapter 6, verse 21. There's one word I wanted you to repeat. And they utterly destroyed. And they utterly destroyed. Listen very carefully. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want to paint you just a small picture. For every man and woman that was in that city, saw the children of God marching and said, hey, not today. Not today. Death won't come in here today. How many of those people with that mindset were destroyed? How many with those mindset were destroyed? next Sunday, I'm going to give my life to Jesus. Next Sunday, just give me one more opportunity, I'm getting out of here. Next Sunday, I'll give my life to Jesus. Everybody in that city that said next Sunday, how many of them were destroying? Just one more opportunity and I'll give my life to Jesus. How many of them were destroying? For the teenager, I've got plenty of time to live. I got plenty of time. Do what I want to do. Hey, I've got a long time. Nothing is bothering me. The world is wide open. The only people that are dying are people as old as the preacher or older. That's the only people that ever die. I've got plenty of time. Plenty of time. Come here, baby Charlie. Come here. I got plenty of time. Can you stay with me? Nearly done. I guess not. Yeah. I've got plenty of time. Plenty of time. Life is good. By a show of hands, have you ever made a decision thinking you had plenty of time to live? Yeah? Everybody that made that decision, how many were destroying? How many were destroying? On the seventh day, when they saw him coming, as many as said, nothing's going to happen today. It's not going to happen today. These morons have marched over here 6 days in a row. They've seen our wall. Matter of fact, they've probably inspected it while they walked around. They realized that that wall, there's no way that little sword they're carrying is going to be able to tear down this wall. So they're going to walk back. And that was their mindset. How many that said nothing would happen again? How many were destroying? So I don't know what your excuse is. But today is your day of salvation. Today is the day that God is speaking to you and wanting to save your soul. Listen to me very carefully. But if you walk out that door, for everyone that rejects Jesus Christ and dies without him by their choice, how many of them are in hell?
All.
How many?
All.
That should scare you to death. Don't leave this place without giving your life to Jesus Christ. Don't leave this place. Would you bow your heads with me? Get my worship team to come. Lord, I come to you right now. Lord, I don't know. Father, if we haven't been close to the sanctuary, God, if we've stopped singing, or Father, we've stopped carrying our sword, whatever it may be, Lord, I pray this altar be full, the hearts be broken. God, I know at times I failed you. Lord, you've shown me, God, just an easy way to make walls fall, but yet, God, it's so hard because of our disobedience and hardness. Lord, I pray right now, God, if there's someone that don't know you, God, you would just speak to them. Someone that don't know you, Father, that's here this morning. Somebody that may be watching at home. Oh, Lord, I pray for that one more soul. One more soul, God. And realize, God, when the trump sounds, all will be destroyed that don't know you. I pray for the one that's thinking they've got plenty of time, for the ones thinking they got life figured out. Oh, Father, there's many just like them that was in that city. They had everything planned out. They thought they could do it. God, they were utterly destroyed. Oh, Father, I pray, Father, you'd move here this morning. God, would you send one, just one, who'd be the one that you're speaking to this morning and give their heart to you? Lord, hear our prayers. As Paul said, I beg you, I beg you, I beg you to accept Christ, if my people, the Jews, would only come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Oh, friend, I pray that for you today. Let God speak to you as we stand together. And all God's people said, amen. Would you come? The altar is open. You may have to move a chair out of the way. You may have to ask somebody to step out of the way. Oh, friend, those that would not get out of their comfort zone, those that wouldn't ask somebody to step out of the way, they're all destroyed. Don't be in that company. Come to Jesus. Listen, as we sing, would you come? Would you come to this altar? You just be obedient, whatever God have you to do, as we sing together.
And though my words fall short, I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? And I could sing these songs as I often do. But every song must end, and you never do. And so I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it's not much, nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. I've got one response, I've got just one move, and with my stretched wide, and I will worship you. And so I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it's not much, nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah,
people sin. You can be seated just for a few minutes. We're going to close out tonight with our drama team, or today. I'm sure they were looking at me like I was crazy, so I sort of skipped that. But we'll let this sort of be our benediction. Thank you. Let's give God's house a hope, a hand. Man, goodness. Get here to the back. a church, give him just a second. Hey, church, tonight, I know there's many of us that's going to volunteer to help feed God's house. I hope to be here. I've asked if we could omit tonight's service. I know our finance team, where you at, Pace? There you are. I don't know how I missed you, right? Our finance team, they should be working on getting everything done for our vote Wednesday night. We'll have regular service Wednesday night, 5:30. Be our meal, 6:30, be our classes. I will try to get words out. If you can't make it and want to see what we're voting on, I know there's a budget right in here, but I can take a picture and send to you. So if you're not able to make it back Wednesday, I don't know, some of you may not be able to, but we'll get that done. Hold on just a second. He's about got it. Oh, look at that. That's all they needed was a song. Bob, you should have sang, man. You know that song. All right, here we go. because I do believe in Jesus changing lives, and our church supports God's House of Hope, because I do believe I see familiar faces. The times I get to go down there and preach, it's just good. But what I want to do this morning, something I don't know if I've ever ended a service with this big of a group. So if you guys could sit down, God's House of Hope. And now, church, we can't all gather at the altar. So what I need you to do, Jordan, come on up here with me. I know that's embarrassing. You and Josie, Kendi, can you come over here where they won't be so embarrassed? April and Daniel, can y'all start back there? Let's form a circle around them, and then we'll pray over them just like we normally do for people that are coming through or different missionaries. So everybody on the right side, we got to make a circle for everybody on the left side. All right, Peyton, come on, step out, man. There you go. Have courage. Come on down here. There you go. And if you can't, just get somewhere where you can put a hand on someone that's in the circle. We got to make this whole left wall here, so somebody's got to go. Keep on coming down there, Pace. There you go. Here you go. I'll move the circle. I'll move the circle. Ring around the roses. Keep around. Keep it good. All right. So our circle is nearly made. Yeah, there you go, Adam. Thank you. I know you got instructions from your... okay, we'll just make a circle around those pews and a circle around these pews. I'm just kidding. All right, let's, is everybody connected? Eric, can you connect hands? Oh, we got COVID. Let's connect shoulders.
Shoulders.
All right, everybody good? We're down? All right. Church, would you pray over the ministries, both the Nelson and the Kilmichael campuses, that God continue to use them? He's the one that changes lives. But God uses them as an avenue. So let's pray and lift them up. Father, I come to you right now, God, as a faith family, Father, from one faith family to the next faith family. God, we lift up this ministry. God, it's not by mistake that they're here today, but God, it's something we all need to hear and worship and praise you. But God, right now, Father, we lift them up. Father, we put our hands upon them, just as Paul, God, when he put his hands on Timothy to encourage them, so that evermore be reminded of the time they sit here this morning and we gathered around and begin to call their ministry out by prayer, knowing, Father God, the temptations, the toils, and the trials, but yet, Father, we only have a vapor. I pray, God, for encouragement. I pray, God, that you would just, God, just pour yourself out, Father, through them, and God, that one more soul might be reached and changed, all for your honor and your glory. Let us live each and every day as a gift from you. Forgive us and we failed you. Thank you for these men and women that are gathered. God, we love you today and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen, amen. Amen. All right, let me get to the back. Sorry. Let me get to the back real quick. Okay, Faith family, I'll meet you Wednesday night at 5:30 for a meal, 6:30 for manna. You are liberty to go to House of Hope. If you'll just stay in here, I'll escort you guys over in a minute. I need to look it up. Hey, I love you, Mother Jones.